Hey, brothers and sisters, it's Brother Patrick, your favorite brother from another mother. Hope you guys are doing all right. Praise God Almighty, through whom all blessings flow. Praise God, all ye creatures here below. Praise God, Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Blessed be the name of the Lord from on high. The name of the Lord is a strong tower, and the righteous run into him, and they are saved. Hallelujah. What a mighty fortress is our God. Hallelujah, brothers and sisters. You know, I just can't stop praising the Lord. I've been wanting to make 100 videos a day if I had the time. I've been busy doing the ministry, so, you know, forgive me for not being on here as much as I'd like to be. And maybe some people are happy. Of course, they might not be watching if they're happy. I'm not on here. Anyway, brothers and sisters, praise God. Praise God. You know, those of you who have been watching my videos for a long time, the Lord has given me these road signs to the rapture, brothers and sisters. Road signs to the rapture. Now, we just had that other one today, this 18th of August. Just another road sign that the Lord had given me of all of these road signs and change of events. Now, I had mentioned in a video the other day what the Lord had told me that I can't remember what I said from the Lord, but it was either the final sign to the Gentiles, the final sign that the church age is over is Israel stands alone. Israel stands alone. And so when the American Congress is not going to be able to override President Obama's veto, or Obama's even saying that he's going to go forward anyway, and already doing the stuff to give all this money to Iran and all that. Israel stands alone, brothers and sisters. Israel's already standing alone. It is going to be formalized and finalized with this treaty or this peace agreement that they made. Now, on about September the 15th, the United Nations will be meeting, and France leading the way to divide the land of Israel. I want to tell you, I know I've said this in videos before. I just want to tell you this. I'm talking in the natural now, not spiritual. This is what seems to be what's going to happen. You know, the Netanyahu's base, the conservative Likud people party, they call it in Israel. You know, the liberal tree huggers in Israel are always deceived, just like in the States, like Obama and them, you know. They have this wacky notions that you can make a deal with the devil and the devil's not going to bite you. So there's no such thing as evil, you know, moral equivalency, as they call it. You know, Christians are just as bad as Muslims, and as far as violence and all this. I got hippie, tree-hugging atheist relatives who told me that all religion is evil and they're all the same. So anyway, in Israel, there's lots of Israelis who are secular Israelis, liberals. They believe they can make a land for peace swap. Like, I give you half of my, if I've got a yard here, let me give you my backyard, and then you'll stop attacking me. You keep shooting at my house saying, give me your backyard, or I'm going to kill you. So I give you my backyard, and then I'm going to believe that you will not kill me now that I gave you the backyard. When in reality, you'll get in the backyard and build a wall or put up some sandbags where I can't shoot you back, and then you'll be able to shoot at me even better. So there's always those liberal, you know, wacky, happy tree huggers who will think you can swap land for peace in Israel. But the conservative Israelis are not going to ever go for that. But listen to me. What's going to happen is that this is the truth. And what the Bible tells us, not all these wacky people on YouTube who are saying that, you know, when Obama got inaugurated, it's a covenant with many and all these kind of things. The Bible is not Amero-centric. It's Israeli-centric. Around the nation of Israel, and all the prophets were speaking about Israel and their close neighbors and the countries that occupied Israel. Like in Daniel, all the countries that Daniel gave a word for in Nebuchadnezzar's dream were countries that ruled over Israel and in history. You got Babylon, the Medo-Persians, the Greeks, then the Romans, and then this final revived Roman Empire, the 10 toes and the 2 feet of the statue of the dream of King Nebuchadnezzar, Daniel chapter 2. So anyway, brothers and sisters, it's not about America. even though America's part of it, part of the Gentile nation, Sea of Nations. Anyhow, so what's going to happen is, what the Bible tells us, is they're going to divide the land. God's going to punish the Gentile nations for dividing his land, like in the book of Joel and other books in the Old Testament. Now, what would it take for Netanyahu to agree to divide the land besides pressure from the UN? Led by Spain. Spain will be leading, or France, excuse me. France will be leading the effort to divide the land of Israel. They're at the UN as the main proposer of this. It's approximately September the 15th. They're going to start talking about this. The base of Netanyahu's support is from the really religious Jewish people, the ultra-Orthodox and all that, different sects. Sects, S-E-C-T, sects of the religion, Jewish religion, like the Hasidics and all that. Anyway, what will motivate them to sell their own left foot will be that they'll be allowed to rebuild the temple on the Temple Mount. Now, that's what it's going to be, brothers and sisters. And that's out of the Bible. Because in the book of Revelation, it tells us how many days they will offer sacrifices. In Daniel, it says that the Antichrist will think to change seasons and times, you know, and he will cause the abomination that causes desolation. As Jesus says, when you see the abomination causing desolation standing in the holy place, he's referring to the literal temple there in Jerusalem, which was, he also prophesied in the same text, Matthew 24, that the temple would be destroyed. There wouldn't be one stone left upon another, which happened when the Romans, under General Titus, destroyed Jerusalem and set on fire, and they crucified over 1 million Jews. That was in about between 68 and 70 AD when all those things happened. So in the future time, the Antichrist, I've talked about this before, there's a type and shadow of the Antichrist before Jesus was born. But it was another future event because Jesus said, when you see it as a future event, spoken of by Daniel the prophet. Now that abomination, because it's desolation in the holy place, he's talking about the Hebrew words up there on the Temple Mount, the holy place, up there in the Holy of Holies. The Antichrist will go in there and declare himself to be God, mid-trib. The Israelis will be allowed, as the book of Revelation tells us, to offer sacrifices for an exact number of days, which is about 2 or 2.5 years. So they have one. I've been through this before. Let me go through this again. This is what's going to happen. I'm just talking about this. The Lord is leading me to talk about it. The rapture is going to happen. And no man knows the day or the hour. Once the tribulation begins, it's divided into two halves of 360-day biblical prophetic years, 360 days. 1,260 days in the first half of the tribulation, and then the same amount in the second half. So, the rapture is going to occur. And then, there will be a man known as the son of perdition, which is Apollonia, the son of Apollonia, the son of destruction, who is a.k.a. the Antichrist, a.k.a. the beast, the first beast, as the book of Revelation calls him. Doesn't call him the Antichrist. The name Antichrist comes from 1 John. In Revelation, it's called him the beast that rises up out of the Sea of Nations, brothers and sisters. The Bible interprets itself. The Sea of Nations is the Gentile world. The Antichrist will rise out of the sea. The second beast, a.k.a. the false prophet, will rise up out of the land. The Bible interprets itself. Look through all the Bible and study this with all those great scholars who know these things and study. Look at the Bible verses. You will see that the land is Israel. So the false prophet will actually be from Israel. The Antichrist will be from the Sea of the Goyim, the Gentile nations. So, the rapture will occur. Then through the UN, you know, they're trying to divide the land, and part of the deal, to seal the deal, this man of perdition, the son of perdition, will come forward and say, we're going to let you rebuild the temple. And they'll get the Muslims to go along with it. Everybody will go along with it. We're going to let you rebuild the temple. Then even the conservative Jewish people will do anything to rebuild that temple, because even their leaders, like Chaim, Rabbi Chaim Richman, you know, the head of the Temple Mount Institute, all those leaders, if you listen to what they say, they will say that, hey, we have got to build this temple. Because it's what that when we build the temple, the Messiah will come. And it'll be a house of prayer for all nations, as it quotes in the Old Testament. You know, I mentioned this before, Jesus, when he beat the money changers, he was in the court of the Gentiles. They were doing the money changing and selling the animals in the court of the Gentiles, the area that Gentiles could come to in the days of the Old Testament. Only Israelites could go into the other section. There was the men, the court of the Israelite men, and then the court of the women. And then only the Levites could go beyond the brazen altar. You know, and then only the, you know, the it's really the Gershites, it was in the part of it, then the Kohens, the direct descendants of Aaron, is like someone with the last name Kohen, or Khan, like Rabbi Khan, you know, the Messianic Jew. He is a Kohen. He is a descendant of Aaron, you know, eligible for the priesthood to be a high priest. And as they do the cast lots and all that for, you know, who would be the priests and then the high priest. Anyhow, so Jesus said, my Father's house should be called a house of prayer. And then the rest of that verse that Jesus quoted from the Old Testament said, a house of prayer for all nations. So the rabbis today say, hey, the temple will be a house of prayer for all nations. So we're going to build this. The Messiah will come and then the whole world will come here. They read those prophecies from the Old Testament. Hey, you know, that through us, the Messiah's kingdom will be set up when we build the temple. They think they can cause it to happen by building the temple. Just like we, the church, people that Christians who study the Bible and the words of Christ know that if we evangelize the whole world, as Jesus said, this gospel of the kingdom shall be preached throughout the whole world, and then the end shall come. So we, the Gentile, you know, the church, which is vast majority Gentiles, only a few Messianic, you know, Israeli Christians, we believe that we can, you know, press to fulfill the word of Christ. That's why you have these different groups who translate the Bible into every language on earth. That's why, you know, missionaries go out. That's why God's called missionaries. And that's why missionary boards push to send out missionaries to take the gospel to the whole world so that Christ will return. That's what we're doing. We're fulfilling the words of Christ. Now, those days are here, brothers and sisters. That time is here, near, even at the door. Now, Brother Gary and I have been, the Lord has led us to keep praying on the phone and talking, and then we met, you know, and we prayed, and the words we've been getting from the Lord, brother and sister, I've only given you a few. The Lord has been giving us words after words every day, and basically, it's time is up. This is it. This is the end of the line. Party's over. You know, it's time for Israel's time. It's time of Jacob's trouble. The time for God to stir up his people Israel. It's time to put an end to all sin, even as the angel Gabriel said to Daniel, you know, 70 weeks are determined for your people. For your people, the 70 weeks are determined for Israel. Excuse me, to reconcile them to God. How do they get reconciled to God? Just as you and I were reconciled through the blood of Yeshua HaMashiach, through the cross of Christ. We are reconciled to God through the cross of Christ. Jewish people, Israelis, have to be reconciled through the cross of Christ just like we did. And that's what God's going to do. He's going to put an end to sin and all those things, as Gabriel spoke there to Daniel. I believe that's Daniel chapter 7. You see the about the 70 weeks that God determined for the people of Israel. He told Daniel, your people. So that's what I'm saying. The Bible is Israeli-centric. You know, a lot of people keep saying Jews all the time, but Jews are just one tribe. There's 12 tribes. We call the religion that they practice Judaism, from the tribe of Judah, who were there in their area was where Jerusalem was. The Levites were the one doing the ministry. The Jewish people had the kings from King David on down, their bloodline for the Messiah. Brothers and sisters, praise God, praise God, praise God! Praise God, brothers and sisters. The tongues of the wicked are about to be stilled by God when he snatches his church out of the snare of the fowler. And the time of Jacob's trouble is about to begin. If you're a born-again Christian and you're right with God and you're prayed up, packed up, looking up, ready to be taken up, you're good to go. That's the end of the line for us on this earth, for those people. But, you know, in the meantime, until we go, our job is to warn people, warn, 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 and let people know what's about to happen. All hell's about to break loose on this earth. As Jesus said, it's never been from the beginning of time until now will there ever be such a wicked time on this earth. And except the Lord would shorten those days, no flesh would survive. And when you do the calculations from all the numbers getting, there's about 1/4, 25% of the people who are here on earth. The day the tribulation kicks off, about 25% of the people on earth will be alive when Jesus returns. And then out of that 25%, we don't know what percent will have taken the mark and what percent will have not taken the mark, who will be the what we call, a.k.a. the tribulation saints. We don't know. And I've talked about this before, how that works. Tribulation saints, as when Jesus in Matthew 25, he divides the sheep from the goats of those people. People that have been raptured, well, we've already been divided. You wouldn't be raptured if you wasn't a sheep. If you were not a sheep on the day of the rapture, then, you know, you were a goat. But then people who repented and became sheep during the tribulation, those are the people that Jesus is judging then. He's not judging the church. That's the tribulation saints and then those who took the mark and all that. And then people that didn't take the mark somehow survived the tribulation but still didn't get saved. Believe it or not, obviously there are going to be some people like that. And they will be with the, you know, they're goats. Jesus said, when I was hungry, you fed me. When I was naked, you clothed me. When I was in prison, you visited me. You took me in and all that. And then they said, when did we do that? He said, when you've done it to the least of these, my brethren, you've done it unto me. You know, enter into your rest. Enter into your reward. And then to those wicked people, to his left, those goats, he'll say, when I was naked, you didn't clothe me. When I was hungry, you didn't feed me. You know, you didn't take me in. You didn't visit me when I was sick or in prison. You know, they'll say, when did we do that to you? And he's going to say, when you didn't do it for the least of these, my brethren, you did it unto me. And that's why, brothers and sisters, even though that's going to be for those tribulation saints, James tells us, show me your faith without works. I show you my faith by my works. Don't you know, O vain man, faith without works is dead. From James, the book of James, the half-brother Jesus. For you know, some greasy gracer tries to contradict that word of God. That's from the word of God in the New Testament. Half-brother of Jesus, James, a.k.a. his real name is Jacob, who was the head of the church. He's in the book of Acts, chapter 15. He was the bishop of Jerusalem. His nickname was Old Camel Knees because he spent so much time in prayer. His knees were like a camel's. And they stoned him to death there in Jerusalem. That's what the church fathers wrote, that he was stoned in Jerusalem. I forgot now if it's 64 or 66 A.D., somewhere along in there. Brothers and sisters, time is short. Time is up. Time to make peace with God. Warn your neighbors, warn your friends. Leave letters for them and whatnot, whatever the Lord leads you to do. Leave them some food. Leave them a Bible. Leave them some notes, videos, whatever. It's time for us to prepare to meet the Lord our God. Now, the many people who might be watching this video, you're going to be left behind. The church age will be over with. The age of grace is over with. You're in a different period. It's the time for he who endures to the end shall be saved. It's a time when you have the option of taking the mark and losing your eternal soul in damnation to hell. If you take that mark, there's no repentance, no turning back. It's a time when the dispensation has changed because Jesus said, Matthew chapter 16, that the gates of hell shall not prevail against the church. But in Revelation chapter 13, it says the beast, first beast, the Antichrist, is given power to make war against the saints, not against the church. The tribulation saints. That's why we call them tribulation saints, because they're saints during the tribulation. But they're not the ecclesia, the called out ones. They're not the church. There's the tribulation saints. Different age, different dispensation, just like the Old Testament, the pre-flood time, before the fall, the flood, after the Tower of Babel, all these were changes in dispensations. Ages. As Jesus said, he would be with the church to the end of the eon, end of the age, the church age. Church is gone. We're with Christ in heaven. He's no longer the high priest for the church. He's preparing to be the groom, prepared to be the King of Kings and Lord of Lords who will return to earth. Right now, Jesus is not operating as the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. He's operating as a high priest, the Bible tells us, seated at the right hand of the Father, ever making intercession for us, the church. He's making intercession for the church. Not for anybody else, but the church. Anyhow, Revelation 13 says that the Antichrist, or the beast, the first beast, is given power to make war on the saints and overcome them. Let this be the wisdom, you know, it says the wisdom and the patience of the saints. He who will be killed with the sword will be killed with the sword. He will be led into captivity, led into captivity. In other words, God's not going to stop the Antichrist from chopping off the heads of tribulation saints. He's not going to stop the Antichrist from enforcing the mark of the beast. And he's not going to stop all of those things, besides the fact that God has 21 judgments himself. Seven seals, seven trumpets, and seven vials or bowls, depends on which translation you got, that he's pouring out on the earth of his wrath, his vengeance for the blood of the saints, the blood of the martyrs, even during the tribulation. So brothers and sisters, like in that text where it says in Revelation chapter 6, I had some person that's very confused who is excited to see everybody killed and is egging on for the tribulation to begin so that everybody can be killed, but her self-righteous self, you know, as an example, people quote from Revelation 6, where it talks about the souls of the martyrs who were under the throne of God, and it says, how long, O Lord, will you, you know, bring, you know, justice for those who shed our blood and our brothers who are on the earth? And he says, for a little while. But see, those people, those souls under the altar are people that have not been resurrected. See, the church is already resurrected. We're not souls under the altar. We will be resurrected saints in a resurrected body there, ready for the marriage supper of the Lamb and go to the judgment seat of Christ, the bema seat of Christ and all that stuff, and the 24 elders with the crowns and all that stuff, leaders among the church. Here is, as a lot of people say, it'll be the 12 patriarchs and the 12 apostles. As a lot of people speculate who the 24 elders are. Maybe. Anyhow, because there's the 12 foundation stones and the 12 gates of heaven are the 12 apostles and the 12 patriarchs. Patriarchs are the sons of Israel. One of them is Judah. You know, all those Judah, Reuben, Simeon, Zebulun, Benjamin, Joseph, there's 12 of them. Anyway, so those people who are crying out, those are people who are martyred during the tribulation. The tribulation's already started. They're not resurrected. When people who are killed in the tribulation, they're not raptured, so they don't get a resurrected body. They're not resurrected yet till later on. So they are souls under the altar. Those people who are crying out for vengeance on the blood of themselves and their fellow servants are people who are killed during the tribulation. That's not the church. Those are tribulation saints who've been killed. Souls under the throne of God, under the altar there, it says. Revelation chapter 6. Anyway, brothers and sisters, I'm doing this teaching. I wanted to preach. Been all fired up today by the Spirit of God. And the Lord keeps reassuring me and giving me prophecy after prophecy, word of wisdom, word of knowledge, prophecy after prophecy, that it's time. It's time. Right now, you know, war is coming to Israel. That's what's coming. War is coming to Israel. And war of destruction is coming to the United States. Massive destruction. I believe this will be, you know, during the tribulation. But it's at hand. That's what you need to warn people. When the rapture happens, all hell is going to break loose on this earth in all ways. Spiritual darkness, nuclear war, and all of these famine and pestilences and earthquakes and all the things we've been having, these birth pains. You know, imagine the birth pains. The birth pains is going to be coming to the final phase there when it's time to push for the return of Christ. You know, the tribulation, those birth pains is all about the return of Jesus. But in the process, oh, it's going to get ugly. And I could even go into, you know, when a woman's going to have a baby, hey, there's blood and lots of bad things, you know, it's painful. And that's just, you know, just a shadow. The woman giving birth is just a shadow and a type of what's going to happen, of course. What's going to happen in the world is a million times worse. You know, each person will wish they was in labor during the tribulation. I mean, that'd be the least of their worries. You know, and I guess any woman can testify that having a baby is very painful and a big deal. And as they say, I've heard people say, you know, it's like going through the valley of the shadow of death. You know, it's like a near-death experience having a baby a lot of times. Imagine living that every day if you survive the tribulation 7 years. of like, you know, your life is like this. You wish you were dead. You know, as the Bible says, you in the morning you say, I wish to God it was night, and at night you say, I wish to God it was morning. You know, I wish this day was over with. Every day is going to be a bad day. Now, the people that take the mark, they're going to have a few good days. You know, they think, you know, with the Antichrist, it's going to have this false prosperity, false peace, and all this stuff. It's just going to be just a few days there, and then the judgments are going to start, and then all the persecution is going to start of people that didn't take the mark. Of course, those people took the mark, their soul's gone. They're demon-possessed. They're on the way to hell. That's the end of the story. People that, I'm talking about people that are tribulation saints, people that don't take the mark. It's going to be hell on wheels day one. It's going to be horrible. You need to tell people that, to be sober. Show them in Revelation where it says, go Google this. It's way near the end of Revelation. I can't remember the Bible verse off the top of my head tonight. I'm tired, but it's Revelation 20, 21. Something like that. It says, I beheld those who had been martyred for refusing to take the mark and not denying the name of the Lord. They had their head chopped off. The punishment for not taking the mark and denying the Lord is to have your head chopped off. You need to make sure you tell people that. Make sure you tell people that are not right with God. The best they can hope for, the best they can hope for is to have their head chopped off and go to heaven. That's the best. Maybe be killed in an earthquake or in a nuclear bomb blast or in starvation, starved to death, and go to heaven. You do not want to be here during the tribulation. You do not want to be here. I beg you right now in the name of Jesus Christ, I beseech thee, by the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, that you make peace with God today. Get right with God. Call upon the name of the Lord while he is near. Give your heart to the Lord. Declare to him you are unworthy, that you're lost and without hope in this world, that you're a sinner, that you're on your way to hell, that you need to be saved, that you believe him when he said, all who call upon the name of the Lord to be saved. You believe him when you said, God so loved the world, that whomsoever shall believe in him, Lord Jesus Christ, shall not perish but have everlasting life. You believe him when he said, if you confess with your mouth and you believe in your heart that Jesus Christ is Lord and God has raised him from the dead, you'll be saved. Repent of your sins, as Peter tells us in Acts chapter 2. Repent. Call on the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. And you should be water baptized as soon as you can. You should do it. Jesus said, if you love me, you'll keep my commandments. The Lord commanded us in the Gospels. He said, go and baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Ghost, making disciples of them. So we're supposed to be baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Baptized in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Ghost. Either one. I baptize people in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. People want to be baptized in the name of Jesus. That's also great. Just FYI that I'm doing all this theology stuff. I don't know why the Lord led me to. But, you know, the Jewish people already had God. So what they were doing, and when a Jewish person becomes a Christian, they're completing their religion. They've already got everything, but they just need to add Jesus as the capstone, as Jesus said. You're the stone that the builders rejected has become the head of the corner, or the capstone. So when a Jewish person, Israeli, gets saved, they're adding Jesus to the gospel they know. And so that's why the Jewish people, Peter said to be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ. He's talking to Jewish people, but to Gentiles, we're strangers and enemies, the Bible says, of the covenants of God. Therefore, that's why we're baptized in the name of that. You know, Jesus said, go in the whole world, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. That's why Gentiles are baptized in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Just FYI. But if someone feels convicted to be baptized in the name of Jesus, I'll baptize them in the name of Jesus. There's no other name given unto men where they might be saved. Jesus Christ is or Yeshua. Some people want to be baptized in the name. Okay. Yeshua HaMashiach is a name above all names. I'll go with that. You can't over-glorify Jesus. I don't have any, you know, that's awesome. I agree. Let's do it. It's no difference to me. The point is that you recognize that you're being baptized. You're buried with Christ and resurrected with him, as Paul tells us. You know that the old man dies and the new man is born again. That's what it represents. It's a shadow of being buried and resurrected. Anyway, brothers and sisters, I'm going to go. I've got lots of preaching to do and prophetic stuff the Lord has shown me. But as I just said, I gave you the synopsis of it. Time's up. The battle for the church is over. I mean, we're just waiting on the Lord. We're already in the going into the midnight hour. The twilight is passing, and darkness is falling when no man can work. So the church is going home. We're going to receive our wages, just like at the people that worked in the vineyard for the master of the vineyard. You know, he came at the 12th hour and paid his servants, and they all got the same wage. Even if they worked 1 hour or they worked 12 and bore the heat of the day, we all get the same reward, as one of the parables Jesus told. Anyway, brothers and sisters, time is short. God bless. I have lots of prophetic things to share with you when I get some more rest. By the grace of God, I'll be able to give some moving in the prophetic live on the video like I normally do. But just suffice it to say that everything the Lord is telling me is this is it. Time's up. God bless you guys. If I don't see you any more videos, which, you know, it could be in next month or whenever. I don't know the date. Lord said now. So now is whenever. The Lord said, it's time is now. But anyway, brothers and sisters, we're going home. So praise God. I'll see you on another video. I'll see you in the air. Either way, doesn't matter to me. It's all in the hands of our Lord, walking and trusting in the Lord and His plans. So trust Him. Put your faith and trust in the Lord in all things. Walk by faith and not by sight. Redeeming the time, for the days are evil, the Bible tells us. God bless you, brothers and sisters.